Tessa. Tessa. Hello. Good morning, TPC. Thank you for joining us this morning, a Palm Sunday, a day of worship and thanksgiving unto the Lord. Thank you for joining us to our friends, our family, our community, everyone that is joining us this morning online. We're so thankful that you are here to be with us. And though you may not be physically here with us, and we may not can see you face to face, you're always in our heart. And you are in our prayers every single day. Pastor, myself, our family, and our team are praying for each one of you. We love you so much. Thank you for being with us. Good morning. And as we begin the morning, I'm going to give you just a little bit of instruction before we begin to pray. So we're directing our prayer this morning from three scriptures: Psalm chapter 16, verses 2-6. 2 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 15 and 16, and Psalm chapter 91. We are encouraging you to read these passages of scriptures every day before you pray. Now, the last few weeks, we have been fervently petitioning the Lord with our request. But today, according to Paul's writings in Corinthians, we are going to begin thanking the Lord for what he has already done and what he is going to do in our life. The psalmist David wrote in Psalm chapter 16 that God was his master. And because God was his master, he, the psalmist David, had a cup of blessing. And David wrote this: Lord, you alone are my inheritance, my cup of blessing. You guard all that is mine. What a wonderful inheritance. The psalmist David was familiar with Psalm chapter 91 because the Hebrew children read and prayed it often. This was a prayer of Moses. It's a prayer of Moses giving thanksgiving unto God for his cup of blessing. So we encourage you over the next 30 days to set a cup out with some pieces of paper and a pen, and each day as you pass by, write a blessing and place it in the cup, or two or three or four blessings. You can even make it a game with your family and set out as many cups as you have, family members, and see who can write the most blessings in the next 30 days. Watch your cup of blessing, as it will overflow. Now, we want you to begin each morning reminding yourself of God's blessings in your life, because God is our master. Our cup of blessing is overflowing. So I want you to join with me as we begin our Sunday morning service with a prayer of thanksgiving and worship unto the Lord. Father, we want to thank you this morning because you are our inheritance. Your word tells us that every good thing comes from you. And we thank you, Lord, for being a good, good God. Your word also reminds us that you guard all that we have. We thank you, Father, that you are a trustworthy and a faithful Father. We thank you, Lord, that you are a mighty God, a God who covers, protects, shelters, leads, and guides us every day. We thank you, Lord, for there is no one as powerful and wise as you. Lord, your word instructs us that you have given your angels charge over us to protect us wherever we go. We thank you, Lord. And this morning, Lord, we thank you for the peace of God, for we need your peace. The peace of God that passes all understanding. We never have to be afraid of anything because you are always with us. And most of all, Father, we thank you for robing yourself in flesh, dying upon a cross, giving your life, and rising from the dead that we may have salvation, life eternal. Thank you, God, that you did not stop there, but that you sent your comforter, your spirit, to lead us, to guide us, to give us power and peace every single day. We thank you for this, Lord. Thank you for giving us all that we have need of every day. Thank you for continuing to give our president and our government direction and peace. Thank you, Lord, for watching over and for keeping our first responders and our medical personnel. We just wanted to come to you this morning in a prayer of thanksgiving and say thank you, Lord. Knowing, God, that we could stand here all day long and never thank you enough. But we thank you, Lord, for your grace, for your faithfulness, for your love, for your mercy to us. And we thank you, God, for healing our land. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet.
Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. When you walk into the room, every heart starts burning, and nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you.
And every hopeless situation ceases to exist. And when you walk into the room, the dead begin to rise, 'cause there is resurrection life in all you do. We love you, and we'll never stop. For you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We want to welcome you to the Pentecostal Church of De Quincy. And as we continue on with this service, I want to challenge you. You're in your home, in your bedroom, in your living room, in your kitchen, wherever you're at. Maybe in your PJs, just in casual clothes. But now is the time to experiment in your worship. There's no one else there to judge you. You're by yourself. You're in your home. And you can just do what you want to do. Don't just listen. Participate. Use this. What's going on is evil right now. But for the goodness of the Lord, we're going to press on. And by pressing on is you in your living room praying and worshiping, not just sitting there listening to service, but interacting. Because the same presence that is in this room is also in your living room, in your kitchen, and even in your bedroom. We just have a few announcements today. And that is, number one, our TPC Kids Sunday School Facebook videos went live at 9 a.m. this morning. Also, our youth Sunday school videos on Facebook went live at 9:30 a.m. And though it's already past those times, you can still go and watch those videos. So there's multiple ways to give. So one way is our app. You can go to the App Store. And if you know TPC at all, it's our little logo, the flame, and you can download it and you can give off of our app. Also, Pastor has past messages on there, sermon notes, so you can go there for a myriad of things. You can also go online to tpcdq.church, not .com, .church, to give online. We can also mail you tithe and offering envelopes to give to you so that you can mail those in to the church. Next Sunday is Easter, and we will live stream Easter Sunday. So please be in tune. If you want to, you can get dressed all, you know, to the nines in your gear. Do what you want, or you can be in your PJs, but please don't just listen, participate in Easter Sunday. We want to thank you for tuning in and listening wherever you're at. We pray that you are healthy, that you are well, and that you are taking the time to pray and read your word, since we have been given a lot of time recently. I also pray that your job will stay stable, and if you have lost a job, that something better will come about after this is all over. We love you, and God bless you.
Hidden glory increase.
has silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens all glory, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. Oh, and you have no rival. Oh, yes, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Oh, and yours is the kingdom, and yours is the glory, yours is the name.
What a powerful name, the name of Jesus. Well, if you have your Bibles, I want you to go to the book of Matthew, chapter 14. And if you don't have it, run maybe into the next room or wherever and go and get your Bible and go to Matthew chapter 14. Well, I know we sure do miss all of you, getting to see you and worship with you in the house of the Lord. But we do hope that you can join us next week. It's hard to believe, but next week is Easter. And we hope that you can join us next week for our Easter online service starting at 10 o'clock. Also, we want to thank all of you. Many of you have come by just to give as unto the Lord this week, your tithe, your offerings. Can't say it enough. Thank you for all of your support. And then lastly, I want to say, if you have not given us your contact information, like a current phone number or an email address, please call the church office and do that. That number is 337-786-4740. Call that number and just give us your latest information, because it's very important that we all stay connected during this time. All right, let's go to the word of the Lord. Let's look at the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 14. And we're going to basically take our talk this morning from verses 22 through 33. But we just want to start reading verse 25. All right, you ready? Here we go. Now in the fourth watch of the night, what does that mean? Well, that's basically between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m., Jesus went to them walking on the water. And when the disciples saw him on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out for fear. Verse 27, but immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, It is I. Be of good cheer and do not be afraid. Amen. Father, we just thank you for your word today. And Lord, we just ask that your word would go forth and that it would encourage the body of Christ in the wonderful name of Jesus. And right there where you're at, say amen. God bless you. Well, one of the first things that I want you to notice is that Jesus, according to verse 22, Jesus made his disciples to get into a boat. He made them get into the boat and he said, I want you to go to the other side. And Jesus himself went up to the mountain and he went there by himself to pray. Now, in God, in all of his omniscience, meaning in his foreknowledge that God knows all things, since God knew everything, he knew that these disciples were going to go into a storm. So the question is, with him knowing they were going to go right into the storm between 3 a.m. to 6, why did he leave them alone? Why did he even let them go into this storm? Well, here's what we learn. We know that every storm that God allows us to go through, he wants us to learn something from it. Because storms test our faith. Say that with me. Say, storms test my faith. Now, the Bible says that when Peter walked on the water to go to Jesus, because the scripture says that he got down from the boat and he walked on the water. But when he started walking to Jesus, the Bible also tells us that the winds were boisterous. And so Peter basically got his eyes off of Jesus and got his eyes on his surroundings. He got his eyes on the waves. He got his eyes on the storm and he was afraid. And he began to sink and he cried out and he said, Lord, save me. Now the storm not only allowed Peter to realize who Jesus was, but it also allowed all the disciples to realize who Jesus was. Because if you look at verse 33 of our text, the scripture says, then those who were in the boat came and worshiped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. Now, storms in our life, brothers and sisters, do not signal that God does not love us. Because even when we're in a storm, he still loves us. We are, according to the scripture, the apple of his eye. In the scripture, the Bible says that he has written us or engraved us on the palms of his hands. So God has not forsaken us. He has not left us. God loves us, but he also understands that storms are allowed for a purpose. You say, Pastor, why are we going through this storm? Well, I don't have all the answers, but I think one of the answers is this, is that storms separate us from our dependence on stuff and helps us to get focused on the Savior. Think about that just a minute. There's been a lot of men and women through the centuries that have lost their life at sea because what was holding them up on the sea went down. But God wanted his disciples to understand man-made stuff is not what is holding you up. I want you to look at Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. I hope it comes up on your screen. Here's what it says, and upholding all things by the word of his power. What does that mean? That simply means that Jesus is upholding the universe today. He's upholding it by the word of his power. He's upholding you and I this morning by the word of his power. God's upholding all things. The reason why when somebody says, man, I'm so sorry that I let God down, I know what they meant. But that's really not the case, because we were never holding God up. How can you let somebody down if you're not holding them up? We're not the ones holding God up. He's holding us up. And he's getting us to realize that the stuff you think that is holding you up, like the government and America and our leaders, and we do, we give God thanks for all of them. But that's not what's holding us up. God is holding us up by the word of his power. Amen. Now, the scripture says the disciples were afraid, and that's understandable. They were in a storm. And as Christians, many times we all battle with fear. You can feel fear all around us. It's in our world. People are afraid. But I want to encourage you this morning. You may be battling with fear. Just don't let it get behind the wheel. See, most people allow fear behind the wheel and they put faith as a passenger. Fear as the driver will keep your car parked, because fear is always afraid. Well, what if I did this? And what if I did that? Fear is not a good driver. Fear in your life will cause you to get stuck. And it's so amazing to me that how many of us, we want control in our life. We want to be in control. Physically, we want to be in control. We want to be in control of our finances. We want to decide who our friends are. And yet, with all the control that we want in our life, it amazes me how we think of nothing about letting fear become the driver in our life emotionally. We want all of this control, and yet we will relinquish that control and allow fear to drive us. And now we see this especially in the Apostle Peter's life. If you look in Matthew chapter 26 and verse 33, Jesus is talking to his disciples. And this is what he says to all of his disciples. He said, "All of you are going to be offended at me this very night." And Peter said, "Lord, I will never be offended with you." And the Lord basically said, "Yes, you will. Even tonight, Peter, you're going to deny me three times." And Peter comes back and says, "Lord, even if I have to die with you, I would never deny you." And so say all of the disciples. So when we look especially at the life of Peter, what we see now as we go back to our text, Peter has this explosion of faith. He sees the Lord, he's coming, he's walking on the water. He gets great faith, and he said, "Lord, if it's you, I want you to bid me to come." And the Lord says, "Come." Peter gets down out of the boat, he walks on the water. This great explosion of faith. And then all of a sudden, he gets his eyes off of the Lord, and he gets his eyes on the storm, and then he begins to sink. And he cries out, "God, save me." Then we see this great staunch belief and faith in Peter. "Lord, I will never deny you." "No, Lord, I would never do that." And God is saying, "Yes, you will." And Peter says, "Lord, even if I have to die with you, I would never do that." You know, one minute Peter has got great faith, and then the next minute he's in great fear. And it just reminded me of something that I read a long time ago that said, people are like tea bags. You don't really know what's inside of them until you put them in hot water. And that's really the truth. You know, I've said this many times before, but when you squeeze toothpaste, if I were to take this lid off and squeeze toothpaste, all of you know what's going to happen. Toothpaste is going to come out. I'm not going to get carrot juice, because whatever is on the inside of this is going to come out. And yes, we are in a storm right now. And yes, we are in a hot situation. And what's going to happen is what is on the inside of us is what's going to come out of us. And that is one reason now why God allows storms and why God allows problems, because problems test our faith. Problems show us what is on the inside of us. You know, I remember reading a story about a man. He was from Tennessee. And all of his life, he had worked in a sawmill. That's his only trade that he had ever known. And it just so happened that one day, his boss walked in and told him, he said, listen, I'm going to have to let you go, and you're not going to be able to come back. And so this man was very distraught. He took 40 years of just working in a sawmill, having a family, having a wife, and he went home and he told his wife, he said, honey, I hate to tell you this, he said, but today I got fired from my job. And his wife looked at him and she said, well, what are you going to do? And he says, well, I'm going to do what I always wanted to do. He said, I'm going to start building. And so what he did was is he mortgaged his house and he built two small motels. And that man's name is Wallace Johnson. And Wallace Johnson took the money that he received from mortgaging his house and he built two hotels or motels. And the name of that company is Holiday Inn. He's now a multi-millionaire. He said this as I read the story. He said, if I could, he said, I would go back and I would thank the man who fired me. Because little did I realize that day when I got fired and I was so full of fear and I was wondering, what in the world am I going to do? He said, little did I realize that God was using this problem to propel me into what I feel like is sincerely my purpose. I want you to notice something about this story, though. Mr. Wallace was afraid, but he did not allow fear to drive his decision. Because if you allow fear to drive your decision, you're going to stay stuck. You have to understand everything that God allows in our life, even the things that come to us that maybe God didn't allow, God has a way of turning it and using what is evil for our good. Maybe you've lost a job. Maybe you're afraid that you're going to lose a job. But I'm going to agree with our son this morning and with my wife that we are believing, even if we do have loss, that God is going to make a way and God is going to open up another door and God is going to even give you something better than what you have experienced. Can somebody say amen? You know, problems have purpose. Problems help us to develop our faith. Everybody goes through hard times. It doesn't matter. We've gone through it. Everybody goes through difficult times, hard times, and setbacks. The question is, how are you going to handle pressure? You handle pressure through experience. You handle pressure by just going through it. You don't learn how to handle pressure in a textbook. You can't learn to read and say, on this chapter, this is how you handle pressure. That's not how it works. You learn what is in you when you go through pressure, when you go through a storm, because whatever is in us is going to come out of us. You know, none of us like pressure, especially we Americans. We like our convenience and we like comfort. We have a love affair with convenience and with comfort. But convenience and comfort is not God's top priority for us. I've said this before and I will continue to say it. Your wonderful mattress that you enjoy is not going to get transposed up into heaven. Your 401k is not going to get transposed into heaven. Your nice vehicle is not going to get transposed into heaven. The only thing that you're going to take to heaven with you is your character. That's it. And that's why God allows storms in our life, because He is allowing this to help perfect our character. That's God's number one goal in our life. And you say, well, if that's God's number one goal, then what is Jesus like? Well, Jesus wants us to be like him. He wants us to think like him and act like him and talk like him. He wants us to love like him. He wants us to have passion and be positive like Christ is. And so since that's true, God is going to take us through the same things that Jesus went through to grow our character. And so let me get back to what I just asked. Well, then what is Jesus like? Well, Jesus is love, he's joy, he's peace, he's long-suffering, he's goodness, he's mercy, he's truth, he's all of those things. And how does God produce that fruit? How does God do that in our life? By putting us in opposing and in opposition situations. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying that we learn patience when we're tempted to be impatient. And we learn love when we're around unlovable people. Say, man, I don't know why I'm around, you know, why God put these people in my path. Because God is using them to teach you how to become more like him. We learn joy in the middle of grief. You know, we learn to wait and to have patience when we have to wait. We learn kindness when we're tempted to be selfish. We learn faith by being in fearful situations. In the days ahead, it may get worse before it gets better. And you know what? We're going to be tempted to just kind of hunker down and to pull back and say, well, we're going to take care of us four and no more and forget about everybody else. But hear me, that will shrink your soul. That will shrink your soul. That is fear. And fear will shrink you. Fear will cause you to get stuck. Fear will cause you to stay hunkered in a parked car. So you say, Pastor, what am I supposed to do during this COVID-19? You know, I'm not going to give you trite answers this morning. The fact is, we don't know how long that this is going to last. But listen to me. It's not about how long is this going to last so that I can just, you know, get through this. That's really not the right question. Let me give you an example. When Joseph went into the pit, 4 weeks after he got out of the pit, I wonder if he said, I wonder, man, how long this is going to last. How long is this trial going to last? Now, he didn't know this, but we know this because we know the word. He basically went into that trial as a young teenager at 17. He didn't come out until he was 30. So if 4 weeks into this experience being thrown into a pit, he would say, how long is this going to last? Well, we could go back to him and say, well, it's going to last 12 years and 11 months. I wonder how he would have took that. That just almost like breaks your heart. See, this is why God just wants to reveal himself, give us this day our daily bread, not our monthly, not our yearly, because if we knew what was ahead of us, we might be disheartened. But God wants us to know that he is with us every day. So it's not, oh my God, how long is this going to last? I can't wait till things get back to normal. No, that's not really the right response. That's not it at all. In fact, that is the wrong question. The question should be, What is God wanting to transform me during this time of my life? How is God wanting to use this to help me to become more like him? How should I respond to the problems and to the storms that are in my life right now? I'm going to tell you something, and when I tell you this, you're going to say, Pastor, you got to be kidding. But here's what James tells us in James chapter 1 and verse 2. James says this, how to respond to the problems of life. He says this, my brethren, count it all joy. Count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Now, I want you to follow me just a minute because you got to be saying, you got to be kidding, Pastor. Count it all joy. My Lord. Now, don't misunderstand me. The writer here is not saying you fake it. He's not saying put on a plastic smile. He's saying to deliberately make up in your mind who is going to be in the driver's seat of your life. That's what he's saying. We've got an attitude adjustment that we're going to have to make through this whole process. And it's our choice to rejoice. I want you to say that with me. Say, it's my choice to rejoice. See, in Psalm chapter 34 in verse 1, one of my favorite scriptures, it says this: I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. This is a choice to rejoice. I'm going to choose to look at what God is wanting to do in my life through this storm instead of focusing on the storm. Because God is showing us that the stuff you think is holding you up can let you down. And it gets your eyes off of the storm, but get your eyes on the Savior. Understand that I'm the one that's got a purpose and a plan for your life. And I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to do you good and not evil. Plans to bring you to an expected end. Just because we're going through a storm doesn't mean God doesn't love us. It doesn't mean that God has forsaken us or that God has forgotten his plan and his calling and his purpose on our life. No, it doesn't mean that at all. It means that problems are allowed in our life so we can truly see what is on the inside of us. So James tells us in chapter 1 and verse 2, he tells us, brethren, count it all joy when you go into these type of trials. And then I believe it is in verse 3, he tells us to pray for wisdom. Why should I pray for wisdom? Well, because anytime you're in a crisis, you need to pray for wisdom. God, I don't know what's going to happen in these next few months, but Lord, I want a good attitude. I want direction. As a mom, help me to have direction, Lord, with my kids staying home. As a father, God, give me direction. Help me to direct my family during this time. God, give us wisdom, Lord. We don't want to waste this opportunity just on frivolous nothing and Netflix and wasting our time. God, what are you wanting to do in my life? And help me, God, not to just grin and bear it. Help me not just to get through this, but to have a good attitude while I'm going through it, choosing to rejoice. And then he says, ask God for wisdom. Why? Why do I need to pray for wisdom? So you can learn from it. Say that, so I can learn from it. So I can learn from it. It's much more helpful if you'll stop asking why. Why am I going through this? Why is this happening? Why me? Why now? Why is not really the question. The question is, God, what do you want me to learn through this? How can I become a better person through this crisis? I'm not going to worry about why. Why doesn't even really matter. What's happened has happened. You know, I've learned and I'm learning that you got to accept what you can't change. Because if you don't accept what you can't change, your mind's going to stay in a turmoil. You're just going to allow fear to be the driver of your life. And if you do, then you're just going to want to hunker down. And you're just going to say, when is this going to be over? How soon is this going to be over? And I'm just going to grit my teeth and get through it. And that's the total wrong response. God is saying what we need to ask ourselves through this is not why and not how long, but rather whom or who am I becoming? So I'm going to encourage you this morning to cooperate with God. Please don't short circuit the situation that you are going through. Don't freak out. Remember God said, my grace, or I believe it was that God said to Paul, he said, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. Now, it took me a long time to get here, but I want you to get this. See, the devil will bring problems into your life to try to destroy you. Don't forget that. The devil will try to bring problems into your life to destroy you. But when God allows problems into your life, it is to develop you. And guess where you're at every day? You're in the center of that. You're absolutely in the center of that. You say, what do you mean? Then I have to make a choice. Am I going to choose to allow this problem to defeat me? Or will I allow God to use this problem to develop me? Am I going to ask why? Or am I going to ask who am I becoming? Am I going to look at this problem as something I'm trying to avoid? Or am I going to look at this problem as, God, I want you to show me truly what is on the inside of me. And I know the only way to see that is when we're pressed. The only way that you get the juice of the grape is for it to be pressed. The only way we become like Christ is for us to be pressed. So let me wrap this up. See, a crisis doesn't just create problems. A crisis often reveals problems. And this crisis may be revealing some problems in your marriage. This crisis may be revealing some problems in your relationship with God. Problems begin to reveal what is on the inside of us. So let this crisis right now begin to show you, man. See, Peter really thought that he was a great person of faith. I just need to say this. I believe with all of my heart that Peter never did believe that he would ever deny the Lord. I don't think he saw that coming. I don't think he thought it was in him. But God knew it was in him. And God knows what is in you. And some of us, we're seeing some things we just didn't even know was in us. That's why the storm comes. So that we can see. Because God already sees it. But we think, oh yes, we're all of that in a bag of chips. But you wait until the storm starts squeezing you. And then you really start seeing what's inside. I'm going to just challenge you this morning. I'm going to challenge you for three things. As I wrap this up, I'm going to challenge you to put your faith behind the wheel and put your fear as a passenger. You say, well, Pastor, you know, as a Christian, I'm not supposed to have fear. Well, one of Jesus's most often sayings in the New Testament was this: don't be afraid. Fear not. Be thou not afraid. He said it often. Why? Because he knew that even as his disciples, we have fear. Why? Because we get to looking around at the storm. We see the winds. We see the waves. We see what's holding us up going under. And we're like, well, oh my God. No. You're not going to sink because he's holding you up. God is just letting you see really what is on the inside of you. So here's my first challenge. Put faith. Faith is going to drive my life. In the morning, I don't know what's going to happen, but I promise you this, I'm going to wake up and I'm going to say, this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice. It's a choice to rejoice. Here's my second one. I'm going to challenge you. Do not allow your problems to defeat you. You have a choice. Oh, I just think I'm going under. No, you're not. Get your eye on Jesus. He's going to reach down. He's going to pick you up. Don't allow your problems to defeat you. Allow your problems to develop you, to bring you more into Christ and his likeness. And then third, I'm going to challenge you. Don't ask why. Don't ask, why is this happening? Don't ask, how much longer do we have to go through this? Those are absolutely the wrong questions. I'm going to challenge you to say, God, who are you wanting me to become? And what, God, are you wanting me to learn through this? Well, before we go, I just want you to know that we love you. We've been praying for you. We're going to continue to pray for you. We're going to get through this together, and this is not the end of the story. I have no doubt, I am certain that this virus and what we're going through did not catch God by surprise. God is still on the throne, and God is still going to use this to grow our faith and to bring people to faith. And who knows, through this, because God normally speaks to people in times of crisis. Through this, there could be a great spiritual awakening and a great revival in our land, because many times God speaks to people through a crisis. Once again, God bless you. If you would, right where you're at, I just want you to bow your head. I just want you to close your eyes, and I want to pray over you. Father, Lord, may we learn from the problems that come our way. And may we know that you're going to use them for our good and not for our evil, if we would just simply trust in you. God, I'm praying today for many of my brothers and sisters who have allowed fear to become their driver. Say, no, I'm pulling you out of that seat. I'm going to let faith drive my life, and I'm going to put fear in the back seat. And I'm not, Lord, by your help, I'm not going to live in doubt, but I'm going to rejoice, and I'm going to remember all the promises of God. And Father, I pray for everyone under the sound, Lord, of my voice who's listening to this. I pray, Lord, that the blood would be applied to the doorpost of their life, to their family, to their finances, to all that is around them. May the blood of Jesus be applied to the doorpost of their life and keep us in this hour. Keep us safe, keep us healthy, and keep us walking in faith. In the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody shout, amen. Well, God bless you. Sing with us as we end our service today. Thank you.
Your blood is a rescue to the sin-stained life. Your blood is healing for the hopeless and broken. Your blood is enough. Jesus is enough. Your blood is a shelter in the middle of my storm. Your blood is my refuge when I'm hurting and alone. Your blood is enough. Jesus, it's enough. It's renewing, restoring, saving and healing, delivering captives, setting us free. It is life everlasting to all who receive it. Your more than enough. It's more than enough. Your blood is a rescue to the sin-stained life. Your blood is healing for the hopeless and broken. Your blood is enough. Jesus, it's enough. Oh, your blood is a shelter in the middle of my storm. Your blood is my refuge when I'm hurting and alone. Your blood is enough. Jesus, it's enough. It's more.
enough. Oh, yes, it is. It's more than enough. Thank you for your blood, Lord. It's more than enough. Oh, it's more than enough. It's more than enough. It's more than enough.